Matthew chapter
53 to chapter 14, verse 13. When a new manager joins a football club, if it's within the transfer window, there is always a flurry of activity. New players must be bought to change the dynamic of the team and to get them to win matches again. And the new manager for Manchester United didn't disappoint on that score when he arrived, buying four new players and bringing in two on loan. And if you're a football fan and a new player's bought, you always ask the question, is this person a good buy? Is he worth the vast millions that the club have paid for him? And there's only ever one answer to that. Let's see him play. I'll decide on the basis of his actions. I suspect that most of us approach life in that way, looking for evidence to back up claims. The proof of the pudding is in the eating, as it were. And so that tends to be how we approach Christianity and, most importantly, evangelism. We think, if I can present this information in the most exciting, persuasive way, then my friends or my family member will believe. And if we try and we get a knockback, we immediately assume it was our fault. I didn't explain it properly, or I was too pushy. And we long for Jesus to make a little miracle to prove what we've been saying is true, don't we? Lord, do a sign, do a miracle, do something so that my loved one will see and believe. But would that work? If Jesus did that, if Jesus did a miracle in front of their eyes, would they then believe? Well, today's verses from Matthew's Gospel help us to see the answer to that question, potentially, and also to see where the real problem lies. So let's look at those verses together. Now, it is a long section, and with the chapter break where it is, we could be forgiven for thinking that I've just lumped two unconnected passages together. But I haven't. I wonder if you spotted a repeated phrase, repeated issue, in both of the sections. Here it is, verse 54. Where did this man get this wisdom and these miraculous powers? And then in chapter 14, verse 2, this is John the Baptist. He's risen from the dead. That's why miraculous powers are at work in him. So it's the miraculous power of Jesus that links these two passages. See, already in his ministry, at this point, he's calmed a storm, he's cast out demons, he's healed the sick, he's made the blind see, and he's raised a dead girl to life again. But rather than kneel down in worship, the people we meet here still refute the claims of Jesus. They still refuse to recognize him and to honor him for who he is. Even with all of that proof right in front of their eyes, they still can't believe. And it's vital that we see this so that we don't get so down on ourselves that we give up telling others about Jesus. Because sometimes even a child raised to life again will not be enough. So let's try and figure out why that is, because that raises questions, isn't it? Well, why would they not believe if they've seen all of that? Let's have a look. Well, in verse 54, we're told that Jesus has returned to his hometown, Capernaum. That's where the family moved to after Nazareth and made it their home. And on the Saturday, Jesus goes to the synagogue, the foundations of which I've stood on in Capernaum, and he teaches the people. And they listen for a bit, and they are quite amazed at what they hear and see. But then they stop. Verse 55, isn't this the carpenter's son? Isn't his mother's name Mary? Aren't his brothers James, Joseph, Simon and Judas? Aren't all his sisters with us? Where did this man get these things? You see, they know him. Or at least they think they do. It's Joe the Chisels boy. Didn't he fit your kitchen last year? His brother, he's the one who was going out with your Debbie until she went off with the Pharisee's son. Ah, so it is. Gosh, he used to play right outside our house when he was a nipper with his little wooden animals. So cute. Well, you can imagine it, can't you? They've got this image of Jesus fixed in their minds. And even the miracles can't shift it. Jesus is, and always will be, the boy they grew up with. And because they won't accept it, verse 57, they took offence at him. And a similar thing can happen with people today. Now, obviously, nobody has actually grown up with Jesus. But they can blindly assume that they know everything there is to know about him. Maybe from half-remembered school assemblies, or if they're of a certain age, Sunday school, that maybe they were sent to as a child. Younger ones might learn things from social media and just can't seem to manage to change that view or to take anything else in. And we live in an age when evidence and truth are less important than our own beliefs and feelings. So don't be surprised if, when you mention Jesus, if you get the courage up and mention Jesus to somebody, that they're not interested in what Jesus could do. They're not interested in his power. They're not interested in the fulfillment of the promises of God. And maybe not even interested in the wonderful peace you know through being in that relationship with him. Because if somebody is set in what they think, then none of that will persuade them. And Jesus responds with the famous saying, verse 57, a prophet is not without honour, except in his own town and in his own home. And so Jesus withdraws, verse 58, he did not do many miracles there because of their lack of faith. You see, there's no point. It wasn't that he didn't have the power, that he needed the belief to do it. It was just like casting pearls before swine, to use his words. Jesus knew when their hearts were hard and that they wouldn't respond. And so he went to the people who would. So that's our first example. The people in Jesus' hometown who thought they knew who he was. The second example is the example in chapter 14, and it's Herod. Not the baby murderer of 30 years previously, but his son. Not that he's any nicer. Because when word of Jesus' miracles reaches his ears, he says to his attendants, this is John the Baptist. He's risen from the dead. That's why miraculous powers are at work in him. Well, that's an odd response. Why would he think it's John the Baptist? Well, maybe because he feels guilty about what he's done to John the Baptist. And the whole sorry story is there in verses 3 to 12. See, Herod was a man who was fueled by his desires. Though he had a wife already, he divorced her in order to marry his brother's wife, Herodias. And she was quite happy with the arrangement. In fact, when John the Baptist was telling Herod that he'd done wrong by marrying her, she was the one who was the most angry about it. Mark's gospel, when Mark tells this account, he says that she bore a grudge against him from that day. Well, Herod had John arrested and put into prison. Often those in power who don't like a message that's been saying do that to the prophets. The children have been learning about Jeremiah, you know, a message people don't want to hear. They throw him in a well. And it's often the same today, a message people don't want to hear. The messenger can end up in a difficult place. So John, thrown in prison by Herod. But Herod, we're told, would go and listen to John. Not that he always liked what he heard, but he found John compelling. But nobody likes to be told they're wrong, especially not a ruler with waning power and battles to fight. He wanted to kill John, really, but was too cowardly to do it. But then came the day of the party. It was Herod's birthday, and so he was having what you might call a boozy lad's night. Food was plenty, the wine was flowing, and the girls danced for the men, including his wife's teenage daughter. And Herod was so taken by this gorgeous teenage daughter dancing seductively. Now, if that's not an image that makes your toes curl, there's something wrong, isn't it? That's not a good thing to be doing. But he's so taken by her that he offers her anything. I'll give you whatever you want. Well, that was Herodias's chance, wasn't it? She told the girl what to ask for, John the Baptist's head on a platter. And even though he didn't really want to, we're told, because he didn't want to lose face in front of his friends, Herod had no choice but to comply. John was beheaded and his head brought in on a dish. Now, many of us might have done things we regret when we've been drunk, but hopefully nothing as monumentally bad as this. And Herod felt guilty. But a feeling of guilt and distress means nothing if it's not accompanied by repentance. Repentance means change. See, he might have enjoyed listening to John, but he was so caught up in his lifestyle and in the preservation of his power that he couldn't bring himself to act on what he'd heard. And when news of Jesus' miracles spread to him, he still couldn't see that this is the one that John had no doubt told him about. He was too caught up in himself. And that can be the case too for those to whom we try and share the message of Jesus. Perhaps they don't want to listen because they're worried that if they do, they might have to change some things in their life. Perhaps their physical desires blind them to the truth of the gospel. Or maybe they just want to bury a nagging guilt they feel about some lifestyle choices. Whatever it is, it can block people from seeing Jesus for who he is. And so they just can't turn to him. So where does this leave us then? Well, maybe then you're here in church or perhaps listening online. You're aware that you've been blocking Jesus out. Perhaps you don't want to know more because you've settled with what you've been taught in childhood. You don't want that shaking because it brings uncertainty. Maybe you're worried about what the cost might be of going deeper or what others might think. Well, if that's you, let me encourage you this morning. Because the joy of knowing Jesus personally, deeply, is the most exciting and fulfilling thing that you can ever do. Some changes might come, and they will probably come. But those changes will enrich your life, not take from it. Remember what Jesus said, "I have come that they might have life and have it to the full." A relationship with Jesus adds to it, brings life that you never knew could exist. Suddenly, life in technicolor. Well, maybe you're somebody who's been discouraged when sharing Jesus with others. It can be hard, and none of us like knockbacks. But just because somebody can't see Jesus now doesn't mean it will be that way forever. The Holy Spirit is the one who truly changes hearts. And remember, he brought people in their thousands to faith on that day of Pentecost and in the years that followed. No doubt some of those people in Capernaum were people who had their lives changed by Jesus later. And he's still changing lives today. So don't give up. Keep on living for Jesus. Keep on sharing Jesus. Keep on praying for those loved ones of yours, that the Holy Spirit will bring his precious gift of faith to those whom you love. God is a God who answers prayer. He does it in his own time. Often we have to learn to be patient and trust him with that. But God answers prayer, and he longs to bring all of those whose hearts are hard back to himself. And so let's pray. Our loving Father, as we think about those people in Capernaum who thought they knew Jesus, yet didn't, we pray for those in our own village and in our own families who think that they know what Jesus is all about, yet who have missed the majesty and the wonder of the reality. So we pray that you would break down those barriers, that you would create a hunger to find out more about Jesus, that you might reveal him to the people of this village in all his power. We pray that you would help us to know when to speak and how to speak and how to be to help them along the way, that you might open their eyes to see Jesus. And we pray for those whose hearts and minds are closed because they're worried about change. They're worried about you asking something of their lifestyle that they're not ready to do. Oh Lord, show them that what you offer is so much greater than anything the world can offer. That a relationship with you is so much more fulfilling and amazing than anything in this fleeting and broken world. So open their eyes too. And help us, Lord, not to lose faith and confidence in Jesus ourselves. When we read the miracles, when we read all the things that he did when he was on earth, when we hear what he's been doing in people's lives today, oh, fill us with a fresh delight in him, that you might strengthen our faith and encourage us day by day. For we ask in Jesus' name.